This morning, the program, as you all know, is on, actually, I don't know exactly what all they're going to talk about, but it's on the nice subject of school funding and the state formula. To help us get that started, I'd like to introduce Brenda Holmes. Brenda is a longtime educator and a former member of the State Board of Education. Brenda?
Thank you, Bob. Thank you. For those of us in public elementary and secondary education, school funding reform has been cussed and discussed for many years with many different solutions that have been proposed. Today, we're delighted that State Senator Andy Menar, a Democrat from Bunker Hill, from the 48th District, who has been part of those discussions for many years, is here with us, and he has his own proposal on school funding reform to discuss with us. Senator Menar has traveled the state explaining and advocating for his position. But first, an individual, one of only a handful of individuals in Illinois with precise understanding of the general state aid, GSA formula, who tried to teach students, local district superintendents, and even legislators how to understand what the general state aid formula actually said and meant, will give us an overview. Dr. Bill Henricks is the only person I know who has, in addition to his unique and valuable knowledge, an affectionate moniker, the Printout King. Without Bill's ability to analyze and translate literally hundreds of legislative school funding proposals over the years, legislative staff, legislators, and school districts would not have known how the latest iteration of a school district funding proposal affected each individual school district. Dr. Bill Henricks.
Thank you, Brenda. I appreciate the opportunity to talk with you a little bit today about school funding. I know you're anxious to hear what Senator Menar has to say, so I'll try to keep my remarks brief. There are three themes that, to me at least, emerge as we've heard all this recent discussion about school funding. Those three themes are, one, there's not enough money, two, the formula's broken, and three, the system itself is just unfair or inequitable. And I'd like to briefly discuss each of those topics. The first, well, there's not enough money. Local school districts raise about $15 billion a year in local property taxes. The federal government kicks in another couple of billion. And the state, through three general pots of money, the equalization formula, supplemental general state aid, which we refer to as the poverty grant, and a third pot, which is categorical funding. Categoricals are all the special needs populations, the special eds, and the gifteds, and the bilinguals, and the early childhood, et cetera. State kicks in about another $7 billion a year. You add those numbers up, you get about $24 billion. Now, you'll forgive me, because as I go through some of this stuff, I'm going to do some general rounding and not be quite technically correct because I don't have time for all that. But there's $24 billion, about 1.8 million kids. You divide those two, you get $13,300 a kid. Now, that's plenty of money. That's well above the national average. And it probably ranks in the top 40% of states nationwide as to money available to spend on elementary and secondary education. I think what we really mean to say when we say there's not enough money is there's not enough state money. And you can be the judge of that. I think the state's contribution has fallen off in recent years. The National Education Association publishes rankings of the state, compare the states on lots of financial education issues. And the most recent data I could find says that Illinois' share of this total funding is on the local level is 66%. 66% of the funding for elementary and secondary education comes from the local side. That ranks second in the nation. Second in the nation. The state, on the other hand, is 21%. That's dead last in the nation. Now, it used to be, remember, I haven't done this for a long time, but it used to be that the state share was 37, 38, 39%, just like clockwork. But in recent times, that share has fallen considerably. Now, part of that is because local property taxes have gone up, but also part of it's because the state hasn't been contributing. The second part is the broken formula part. Hear that a lot. What we talk about is the formula, the general state aid formula, consists of two parts, as I said before. One is the equalization component. The other is the poverty component. I'll talk about each of those separately. On equalization means that the amount of money you get from the state is inversely proportional to property wealth. If you have a lot of property wealth, you don't get very much state money through this formula, and vice versa. That's the way it's designed. Here's the way it kind of works. The state says it should cost $6,119 to educate a regular old kid sitting in a classroom someplace. If you're a district superintendent, here's the way you figure it. You take the number of kids you've got times $6,119. That's your overall need. That's what it should cost you to educate these kids. From that, you subtract what you raise locally. That's your adjusted property wealth at a fixed tax rate that the state decides. You subtract those two, that's how much state aid you get. Now, that's not a complicated formula. That's hardly algebraic. But that's the way it works. Now, one of the problems with that, though, is that $6,119 is kind of an odd number. We may get to talk about that later. But that's been the same for 7 years. That has not been increased for 7 years. And now the state has to prorate that amount, which is another whole topic that I don't have time to get into. There have been adjustments along the way, the most notable of which is the adjustment for we call it the double whammy, the property tax extension limitation law. I guess I would say that if that support level, instead of $6,119 were $8,000, we probably wouldn't be talking about anything. That is if the state funded it $8,000. The second part of the state aid formula is the supplemental low income or the poverty grant. That's a good formula. It's algebraic. It's a little more complicated than the other one. But basically what that says is that every school district gets the square of its concentration. We have this measure of these at-risk children, these poor kids. And you look at your concentration, you square it, you get $2,700 for each one of them. I read in the paper that it's not a fair formula because Chicago gets 40% of the money, they only get 30% of the kids. Well, that's the way it's supposed to work. That's the way it's designed to work. The higher the concentration, the more you get. Chicago has 351,000 kids. 315,000 of these children are designated as at risk. That's 90%. You take 90% and square it, 81% of $2,700 plus. That's over $775 million they get just from this grant. And that's not equalized. Now, the cost of this grant is $1.9 billion each year. That's up from $800 million in 2008 and $400 million in 2004. That's a lot of money, folks, for this supplemental grant, $1.9 billion. There's over 1,050,000 of these kids. That's up from 660,000 in 2008 and 510,000. In 2004. So over 12 years, the number of these at-risk children in this state, this measure, it's a measure, it's a count that's furnished by the Department of Human Services has basically doubled. And what's amazing is that over this same time period, the number of kids has remained fairly constant. So I'm not sure, I haven't been around a while, I'm not sure exactly why that is, but I know that $1.9 billion is too much. The third thing, I gotta get my papers right here. The third thing is equity, fairness. The system's not fair. School finance, that's not just a word. Equity can be measured statistically. There are volumes written in school finance about equity. And school finance equity refers to reducing the variation in revenues among school districts, either that or lessening the dependence on property wealth. That's what equity is about, and all that stuff can be measured. Now, state policy, I think by default, I'm not sure there's any conscious policy about pursuing equity. We talk about it a lot. But we talk about two types of equity in Illinois. The first is called horizontal equity. That's that old regular kid in the classroom. That's the formula stuff. You want to reduce the variation of revenues. The other type of equity that we talk about, which really gets very no play whatsoever, is vertical equity. That's over on the categorical side. Vertical equity talks about treating students that are somehow unequal, accounting for those differences. Now, Senator Menard is going to follow me in a few minutes. I think he has a proposal that's going to kind of combine all of that stuff. I don't want to speak for him. But that would be a policy change in Illinois. And if that's the policy that we want to pursue, all well and good. We should maybe give that a try. How do you get more equity? Everybody says, yeah, we need a more equitable system. Well, how do you get that? Well, it's my experience that there's only two ways of doing that. One is that you increase state taxation, either through the income tax or broadening the sales tax base. And this is important, and putting those proceeds into education through some equalization mechanism. The other way is to take money from high property wealth school districts, either through giving them less state money or through somehow sharing their tax base with the state and redistributing that money. The two ways that have gotten the most talk is to one, have the locals maybe reduce their taxing authority by a dollar and give that dollar to the state. Well, what would that do? A dollar, there's basically $300 billion in property wealth, so a dollar on that would be what, $3 billion. So that would transfer $3 billion of local wealth to the state. And if they put that money back in through the formula, that would certainly reduce the variation in expenditures. The other way of sharing that base is to split it. And then all these things have been talked about for years, and there's no political will at all to do any of this, of course. But the other way is to split the base. Leave the residential base with the local school district, and take the commercial industrial base and tax it at the state level. That would get your power plants and your shopping malls and all of that stuff. That would even out that. So those are the only two ways of doing it. There's some things that could be done, at least in my opinion, to help with equity in the short term. But maybe we'll get to talk about those a little later. Thank you.
Make sure I got all my papers.
Senator Menard, who has a PowerPoint?
But I'll commit to not going through every slide on the PowerPoint because it's early. Bob, thanks for the invitation to be here. When this was posed to me, he told me that Brenda and Bill were going to be part of the panel. And many years ago, I was a staffer at the Senate, as most of you know. I was staffing the Education Committee, and Brenda, I think at the time, was working for the State Board of Education, and Bill was as well. Bill was the printout king. He was the name and the face of for the legislature at the time for how to understand how numbers work in this complicated mess of school funding that we have in the state. So for me personally, it's a real treat to be here with both of them. I had never met Bill before just a few minutes ago, but we had talked on the phone many times back in the early 2000s. So it's a pleasure to be here with both of them. I'm gonna get into some of the details of the bill in a moment, but I just want to tell a little story because I think it would be appreciated by the audience here this morning. I usually begin this discussion. By the way, I give the same discussion, use the same slides if we get them up here, wherever I go in this state. So a couple weeks ago we were at Loyola in Chicago. Last week we were in Harrisburg. 3 weeks ago we were in East Moline, Taylorville. It's a weekly meeting somewhere in the state. I use the same slides, go through the same PowerPoint, which I think is important because if there's nothing that divides the state more on geography, it's school funding. And it's unfortunate because it's such a politically charged atmosphere to begin with at the State House. When you layer in, you know, billions of dollars, 860 school districts, hundreds of thousands of children, school boards, administrators, it's a highly charged topic. And just for my own purposes, I try to be as consistent as possible, not as convenient as possible, because obviously what you say in Harrisburg might get you applause, which is very different than what you say in Chicago, which might get you applause. But nonetheless, I try to do the same thing everywhere. This started for me as a member of the Senate shortly after the 2012 election. I met with superintendents in the 48th Senate District in Litchfield, in the basement of the hospital. They cordoned me off, and I think it was the end of November, right around Thanksgiving, before Christmas. Put me in a room and said, here's our problem, Senator-elect, here's our problem. I was aware of the problem as a parent of three kids in Bunker Hill. Aware as a former chief of staff, former staffer at the Senate. But I walked out of that meeting with a very clear message and charge from the superintendents that I represent that absent of change, their financial situation was not just going to continue to erode, but the bottom, their base, was just going to be completely pulled out. But this actually started for me many years ago. It would have been in 1997, which was, I think the year, was it 96, when Governor Edgar, 97, Brenda's shaking her head. Governor Edgar called a joint session of the General Assembly to put forward his proposal that would have dramatically changed the system at the time. And my state senator at the time was Vince DiMuzio. I'd gotten to know him shortly before that. And he called me one day out of the blue and said, hey, Menar, you want to go to Springfield? And I said, great. I was in college. And I said, where are we going? And he said, Governor Edgar's going to, you know, give us this plan on school funding. You want to go listen to it? And I said, yes, I do. And so I sat next to him and Gary Hannig in the House chamber as Governor Edgar talked about in great detail many of the issues that we're still struggling with today. His plan would have went a long way to change that. That plan wasn't passed by the Republican-controlled Senate. It was passed by the Democratic-controlled House. But there was not an agreement, so a compromise was struck, and that's what's in place today, 20 years later. And that's the nature of the challenge that we face today. Same challenges that Governor Edgar attempted to address with his bold proposal 20 years ago, layered on now is a state that's changing dramatically and has changed dramatically over the course of 20 years, but we're still shelling out $13 billion the same way as we were in 1997. I start here. This is a paragraph from a book called Savage Inequalities. Bill mentioned the word policy, which is important word in this discussion, because what's before the legislature and Governor Rauner with the bill that I'm sponsoring in the Senate that's now on third reading, similar to previous proposals but different, is a policy change. It's a policy change. And it seeks to address what I think this paragraph describes in this book. This book was published in 1991. It was standard reading for someone that most students in Illinois probably still is that are going into teaching. And I was introduced to this book by a professor at SIU. I'll give you the Cliff Note version of those couple of sentences. But what the author here says is that we as a government, we as a democracy have a policy that compels attendance to school. So we by law compel attendance, but we don't by law compel equity in public education. And this isn't just Illinois, it's all over the country. So we compel attendance, we don't compel equity by law. So we by extension compel inequality with our laws. And so what Bill described is the law. It's not a budget. It's not a budget. Budget has something to do with it. But it's the law of the state in the school code. Pages and pages of text that Bill probably could recite today, I think, if he was asked to. I won't ask you to do it, Bill. But it's the law that directs money from the state budget to 860 different places in Illinois. So at the root of our challenge is the discussion about how the law sets up inequity today. And that's a pretty scary proposition for a lot of people in the legislature, and it should be. It should be, because I'm going to show you why. The policy change that we're proposing wouldn't completely fix the gap, the challenge, the gaps that I'm going to show you, but it would address sizably some of those most important challenges that we have in the state today. There's a lot of proposals that go much further than what we are proposing today. For example, Bill mentioned that some other states reach into local districts that have immense wealth when it comes to property values and pull money out and redistribute those property tax resources to other school districts. We're not proposing that, for example. There would be no political will to do that. There's other proposals that would completely realign how assessments are made. I think Bill mentioned that one. We're not proposing that either. What we have done in a bipartisan way thus far in the Senate is to deal strictly with the distribution model. Whether there's a lot of money in it or not a lot of money in it, we're dealing with how do we distribute money, whether we have a mountain of money to distribute in a year or not a lot, because how you distribute that money, what the law says, how you distribute that money makes a profound difference for school districts. Hey, Alec, would you go to slide 4 for me real quick? I won't bore you with the history of this, at least for me. So Bill mentioned the relationship between property taxes and state resources, federal resources. It's different for every school district. There's not a one-size-fits-all metric for how many state resources or federal or local resources go into a school district's budget. I think what's important to note, piggybacking off of what he said, is that in Illinois, because we contribute so little as a state to education funding, which drives up the necessity for local resources, there's a cost to that, and it's in your property tax bill. And when there are calls, for example, property tax freeze or a property tax rate freeze or things of that nature coming from Governor Rauner and others in the legislature, it would be irresponsible not to address that issue by recognizing that if you shut that off, then state resources are going to become all the more important. And that has to be part of that discussion. So it might be hard to see, but there's a little shaded area right there on that far right bar. And if we were just to fund proportionally what the average state funds to their public education system, that would save a lot of money for property taxpayers. But But we don't do that in Illinois, and we have to get there. That's going to take years and years of investment in public education. But the point of this, and what I'd like to say to people is, you know, people say, well, we need to freeze property taxes and that'll fix it. Well, what that will do is it will shut off one spigot to public schools, and without turning on another one, we would see devastating cuts in places that have already experienced devastating cuts. Number five, Alec. Okay, we had tons of hearings for this, and I'll get to some of the specifics of the proposal in a second, but I want to point this out because this was kind of a moment when we kind of reflected on where we were in the Senate when we had public hearings. We produced a report back in 2014. It was produced a day early, which was good. It had eight members, four Democrats, four Republicans on it. We came up with suggestions on how to amend the current formula, all of which are incorporated into the bill today. But we had a report from a group that came from out of state that did an assessment of Illinois. How do we spend our money? Can we do better? What do we do well? What do we not do so well? What do other states do that have proven effective in states like Illinois? Because we're not Kansas or Iowa. We're Illinois, very diverse. And one sentence that came out of this report from Augenblick, Palish and Associates, did I say that right, Brenda? You've had experience with them. Augenblick, thanks, Bill. They've been around for a while. And they know Illinois well. Was that we conclude that the Illinois school finance system is inequitable for both students and taxpayers. So that last word, students and taxpayers, that word taxpayers is oftentimes left out of this conversation. So think about that previous slide. And this is what they meant. This is what they meant when they said that. And usually when I get to this point, people look at me like I have five heads on my shoulder. Because this is stunning. It's absolutely stunning in Illinois. So in East St. Louis, by the way, this chart was created in 2013. In East St. Louis, the tax rate is $7.49, so 7.49 in 2013. With that tax rate, which at the time was, if not the highest, pretty close to the highest tax rate for a school district in Illinois, they generated $1,200 per student. So a $7.49 tax rate in East St. Louis generated $1,200 per student. They have a 99% poverty rate. On the other end of the spectrum, and this is an extreme example, but it's meant to be illustrative to what the report said. In Arlington Heights, District 214, the tax rate at the time was $1.84. With the $1.84 tax rate, the district generates $18,400. So what the report was saying that in this instance, East St. Louis couldn't tax themselves enough mathematically into equity, even if they wanted to. Now, when you layer in state funding, that's local funds, when you layer in state funding under today's formula, the cost drivers for East St. Louis, the metrics that are used when printouts are made and determinations are made, how much goes to which district, East St. Louis, year after year after year, has been reduced by the state budget, despite the fact we spend more money in the state budget on K through 12 education. Arlington Heights has been rewarded with more money. So today, East St. Louis's tax rate is just shy of $10, and they still produce $1,200 per student. So go back to that word taxpayers. There's a correlation between per pupil spending and property tax rates, but it's opposite of what most people think. The correlation is this: the higher the tax rate, the less is spent per pupil. That's a general metric in Illinois today, which is opposite of what most taxpayers and citizens think. Most people say that if you have a higher tax rate, you spend more. And that just simply isn't true in Illinois. We have districts that have enormous tax rates, putting enormous burden on lower class neighborhoods, working class neighborhoods, neighborhoods where poverty is deep and strong, and they can't tax themselves enough to get what they need to produce a quality education for their students. And on top of that, the state funding formula is punitive to them today. That's our challenge. Right there is our challenge. The gap today, and there's reasons for this. The lowest spending district in the state is Germantown District, which is a elementary district kind of south and east of St. Louis. They spend just above $6,000 a student. The highest spending district is the Rondout District, which is also a very small elementary school north of Chicago, and they spend just shy of $31,000 per student. Alec, let's go to slide 8. All right. How do we compare to other states in terms of investment in low-income students? So I focused a lot of time on students that live in poverty, students that are counted in our formula as low income. That's because that's what we were directed to do by those that came to us, gave us testimony, said this is what you can do better. Bill mentioned that we spend a lot of money. We spend a lot of money on schools. But fewer of those dollars every year are invested and spent in districts that serve students that live in poverty. It's shifting away from students live in poverty. We see it every year. We saw it in the governor's introduced budget. Those numbers were produced last week. And you can see dollar for dollar shifts away from places like Taylorville into places like Winnetka. Taylorville goes down, Winnetka goes up. That's what our formula does today. So in Illinois, you can see we're all the way to the right. We spend 81 cents on the dollar for a student that lives in poverty against a student that doesn't. This is opposite of where investment ought to happen in our state budget. Ohio would be the most progressive state. It's $1.22. By the way, three or five years ago, that was not 81 cents, it was much higher. Matter of fact, when the formula was enacted in 97, we would have been right about in the middle of the pack. We probably would have been on the more progressive end of the pack. But we haven't kept up with those changes. And so that has let us slide further to the regressive side. So absent of change, and I want to make this point very clear, absent of change, that 81 cents on the dollar for students that live in poverty is going to get lower in Illinois, as a function of today's formula continuing to work every year. So we should, if I'm here in 2 years, still at this, which I will be until it gets done, that number is going to be less if I'm standing at this podium in 2 years. I guarantee it. Because 2 years ago, it wasn't 81 cents. Why is this important? Because we know, it's a fact, it's been documented, it's been researched, that if you have two students, one that lives in poverty, one that doesn't, you can get the same outcome in high school. It just takes a little more money for that student that lives in poverty. Not a whole lot, just a little bit. Does have a cost, but that cost pales in comparison to the cost of not fixing the problem elsewhere in the state budget. When you think of unemployment, when you think of the Department of Corrections, when you think of Medicaid, all of those expenses that continue to grow, a part of that is because we're not attacking poverty in the classroom with our funding formula. And we can do a better job of that. It's one thing our bill accomplishes. Number 11, Alec. All right, one of these metrics that's really hard to, not hard to talk about, but you know, I get some groans from people, but you know, Brenda, what did you say? Cussed and discussed? I like that, actually. I get cussed and discussed all the time over this. This bottom half of the page. So when you peel back a couple layers of what does that mean? You know, put it in real numbers. People say to me, what does that mean for the average kid? So in Illinois, if you are an African American student, on average you have $2,000 less per year spent on your education as compared to your white counterparts. Now there's exceptions to that rule. But this came from a group called the Education Trust, which is a nonpartisan national group that does an assessment of every state. Largest gap in the country, right there. Students that live in poverty, so any student that lives in poverty, regardless of the place in the state, on average has $2,500 less spent on their education per year. Think about that for a second. That's $2,000 a year per year for 13 years. That's what that means. Quantify that. Think about that for just a moment. What could change if we could get that right, especially students living in poverty? That gap gets bigger every year as well. Let's make it local. Number 12, Alec. So for Springfield, Springfield receives about 52 million, District 186 receives about $52 million in annual state support. And that's relatively stable. It's relative, I don't want Mike to heckle me in the back there, but it's relatively stable. You know, it goes up and down depending on, you know, changes that are put into the formula to distribute money. But comparatively speaking to other districts in the state, it's a relatively stable number. But here's the challenge for Springfield. If you were to determine what's adequate for the students that District 186 serves, District 186 is about $2,200 below what's adequate. What is adequate? It's the number that we attach to a district to produce the outcomes that we expect from the school district. So one of the largest flaws, I think, in the formula today, and by the way, this is not a judgment on anybody. I'm not judging anybody here, because the state was very different in 1997 than it is today, is that we set adequacy the same for every school district. So the law says what's adequate for Springfield or East St. Louis is what's adequate for Lake Forest or Winnetka. And that just isn't logical. It isn't logical. It doesn't make any sense. The students being served in some districts have greater needs than students in others, but we don't recognize that in the formula. But what we do is we expect all districts to produce the same outcomes. Same tests that are standardized, same expectations, but we don't drive resources to the districts that need a little more to meet those expectations. So in District 186, we're $2,200 below where we ought to be for a spending level that would meet those expectations. I'm gonna show you another stunning one, number 14. Slide 14, Taylorville. Taylorville is almost this is one of the largest gaps in the state. Taylorville is almost $5,500 below where they ought to be spending for the students that they serve. Their change is happening in rural parts of Illinois that have been happening for years that are going unchecked by our state aid formula. Growth of poverty, rising unemployment, you know, declining tax base, declining population. Those things are troubling aspects of how the state aid formula accounts for funding. All of those things aren't accounted for in our formula today. So that results in spending gaps in places like Taylorville of almost $5,500 per student. $5,500 per student. Let me show you Chicago, number 17, Alec. I get booed sometimes when I bring this one up downstate, but we need to talk about it. So Chicago's low income percentage is 89%. They serve 350,000 students. It's about 20% today of students enrolled in public schools. They have 18% English language learners. By the way, previous slide, this is one of the largest growth areas in the state that's unaccounted for in our formula. East Moline, for example, has 1 in 5 students that are English language learners. East Moline. But you wouldn't know it by looking at our budget. You wouldn't know it. So Chicago is 18% English language learners, 14% of students with IEPs. They spend $15,000 per student, which is above the state average, but when you back out their pension payments, because they make them on their own, the state makes them on our behalf, downstate and then suburbs, but Chicago pays their own pension payments. That's about $2,000 a kid. So they spend about $13,000 per student. So when you account for all this, given the challenges of the district, they're well below adequacy. They're $3,700 below adequacy. Same challenge as Taylorville. Same challenge as Taylorville. I'm going to finish up on telling you what the bill does. Next slide, Alec, 18. So Bill mentioned that we have categorical grants, we have equalization grants, we have supplemental grants in today's law. It's in the law. What we're proposing is what we call an integrated formula. So there's different buckets of money in the state budget that serve different types of school districts. And what that sets up when budget making happens is, you know, certain constituencies in the legislature are rewarded. and others aren't. And for example, when you want to get a budget passed and you need downstate votes, then you put money into the transportation reimbursement line because that disproportionately is distributed to downstate schools. When you need suburban votes, you put money into the special ed categorical lines because that's distributed evenly per pupil, not based on need. So those things have been cobbled together over the course of 20 fiscal years. And at the end of the line, every year, at the end of the line, were students who live in poverty. So we spend less than 40% of our money in the state budget for K through 12 education applying a metric of need, asking the question, what do you need, school district? So we're saying that should be the first question we ask on nearly all of our money. So we propose a formula that distributes money based first on need. The next thing we do is we try to incentivize things. For example, we want to reward districts that enroll students in dual credit courses, advanced placement courses, things that drive economic growth. So we have developed a model to do that too. That's rarely talked about in our bill. But it's intended to be simplistic. It's intended to have a statewide formula, not multiple formulas that are intended to serve different districts. And it's intended to drive resources first to students that live in poverty. Bob, I think I'll give you this slide deck in case anybody wants it. But I think I'll stop here, Brenda, and be happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Well, golly, what about the lottery money?
So I skipped over that slide. It's always the first question. Lottery revenues have been relatively stagnant for years, so we should account for that first. Second of all, it provides, I think, on average in a given year, about no more than 8% of what is spent on K through 12 education. Important 8%, but at the height it was about 10% of the total. Obviously, if we didn't have that, we would be in much worse shape than we are today, but it's a very small amount of the greater total of state funds. When you layer in, you know, federal and local, it's a very small number.
Thank you. Dr. Henricks, why is it that Chicago gets more money? Everybody knows that.
I'm not quite sure I understand that. Chicago is a wealthy school district in terms of formulas. As a matter of fact, Chicago, if it weren't for some adjustments in the formula, would not even be in the formula. If it wasn't for that property tax extension law adjustment, Chicago would be what we call an alternate method district. They wouldn't be in the main part of the formula. So of the money available through the formula, Chicago doesn't get very much of it, really. They get a lot of that poverty grant money, and they have, I'm not sure about all the categorical stuff, I don't get into all that, but they have their own block grant, right? They have their own block grant that accounts for a lot of those categorical programs. So Chicago's, if you say they get a lot of money, it's because they're big. They've got 350,000 kids, and a lot of special needs, a lot of poor. But if you look in this, They get more money than anybody else, but that's because they're so big.
Thank you. Are there questions from the audience this morning? Bill, you want to please stand up? Bill?
Thank you.
Andy, real quickly, what's the percentage of low income in Springfield? I missed that.
Bill is asking about the percentage of low-income students in the Springfield School District.
I think it's 80%.
80%. Super. Yes, sir.
Well, to both of you, if the current formula is based on one element you said was the equalization element, and another was the that's designed to equalize the funding based on the local effort. And you said there was an element of poverty formula, which gives a certain amount for, you know, the poor kids. How does it work come out in the end that the rich school districts are getting more state aid than the poor school districts?
So, Sam, one of the heavier metrics in the formula today is attendance. So it's the number of students that a district serves. Without as much of regard as I would argue to the challenges that the students have. So generally speaking, if the district is growing, you know, so if the enrollment grows or grows faster than the state as a whole, they are going to receive more state funding. Which sounds, it's logical, right? That's a logical path for school funding. But my argument with the bill is that we have to, can't hear me, I'll speak loud. We have to go a little bit deeper. We have to go a little bit deeper because we do have a poverty grant today, but it's become such a small piece of the overall puzzle that its effect is not being felt. So to me, the predominant factor should not just be how many students do you have, it should be what are the characteristics and the challenges of those students, and we should weight that heavily. And that should start with students that live in poverty, because that's almost an afterthought today. Because the first question we ask is, do you have more or less? And we almost ignore the challenges that the students that we're asking, are there more or less? So that should be a factor, but it shouldn't be the predominant factor. So we're saying the most predominant factor ought to be what's your poverty rate, how many students in poverty do you serve, and then go from there.
You still want me to talk about it?
Yeah.
The way we do things now on those two grants, the equalization and the poverty, I kind of disagree. There's too much emphasis on the poverty. $1.9 billion. Now, we have to understand that these children, and again, these are not really identified kids. It's just a number associated with the district. That's all it is. It's a number. Somebody says this district has this many kids associated with it. These kids, and I'm not against giving money to poor kids, so please don't write that down. But these kids are already counted as part of the attendance. Plus, there are state programs for free lunch and breakfast. There's early childhood programs. There are federal programs that are child nutrition programs and all the title programs. There's a lot of money, other than just the state, that goes into providing funds for these educationally at-risk kids. In my opinion, there's about $3.1 billion that go into the equalization part of the formula. There's about $1.9 billion that goes into the poverty. That's way out of whack. I said that support level, that 6119, hasn't changed for 7 years. What we should do is take part of that poverty money and increase the support level. That support level, we don't even appropriate enough money to fund the 6119. When we prorate that, that is disequalizing. Wealthy districts benefit more from prorating an equalization formula than poor districts. We should never, ever prorate equalization. That's just simple algebra. Now, I would say, I mean, pick Jason at the state board or Tony Wagner, even me, you give us a data set in a couple of days, we can come up with a formula that's the same, that does the same thing, but costs a lot less money. You take that money, you throw it over into the formula. Let's say you take that $1.9 billion down to $1 billion. $1 billion is still a lot of money. You take $900 million, increase the support level. You could probably put the support level up by $500. Poor districts, property poor districts, would benefit more. I even think Chicago might benefit from that, even though they get $775 million through that grant. I'm not sure of that, so don't quote me, but I think it'd be close. Poor school districts, property poor school districts, I believe, unless they have very, very high concentrations, would benefit more from higher support levels than putting this money in a non-equalized poverty grant.
Other questions? Sheila.
Andy, what's the, where's this at, and what's the chance of it, where's the bill at?
Yeah, so real quick.
Chance of it going anywhere?
Yeah, I'll get to that. I just want to, we didn't have it, we actually had an agreement here, believe it or not. So, one thing we changed back to Sam's question is that, you know, if a district spends well above adequacy, they don't need a supplemental grant to spend more on kids in poverty. So today, if there's a student that lives in poverty in a district that spends twice as much as what's necessary, we say we're not going to give you that supplemental grant for that number in poverty, because we can use it in districts with high concentrations of poverty that are nowhere near adequate spending. So Bill's absolutely right. We can spend that money better elsewhere, and that's what, so we don't grow the cost of that. So we can spend it more effectively somewhere else, which is the nature of the disagreement on how to move forward. So the bill was passed out of the executive committee 2 weeks ago, or excuse me, last week. It was a 10-1-7 vote. So there were seven members voting present, 10 voting yes. I would expect that we would call the bill the week we return in May. So next week there's going to be a couple of hearings, and we'll call the bill for a vote in the Senate. And then the House would begin its process the month of May.
Let me see. One more quick thing about the poverty. When the formula was passed 20-some years ago, there was a poverty grant. And originally, if a district had less than 15% concentration, they got nothing. They got zero. So that would have allowed more money to go into the higher concentrations. But you know how things go. Well, that didn't stay very long. So now if you have one kid, you get $355.
Even if you spent $30,000.
Even, yeah, it doesn't matter how much you spend.
Yes, sir.
A couple years ago, I heard that Illinois had more school districts than any other state. And also politically, several years ago, consolidation of school districts was high on the priority list. Where is that? Is it off the table? Would that affect the finances?
Yeah, I don't think it would dramatically. If you take two downstate rural districts that are neighboring with each other and they're struggling with finances, you're just going to have one larger district struggling with finances. So the only way that would severely change what we're talking about is if you take a district that is wealthy and a district with property resources and one that isn't and do a consolidation that way. I think where there is some efficiencies, though, is, you know, we have elementary school districts and high school districts and unit districts. We're used to unit districts here in the central part of the state. And oftentimes the consolidation fingers pointed at downstate, but if you go through the suburbs, there's elementary districts on top of high school districts, and there could be some efficiencies there in terms of curriculum, in terms of spending alignment, things of that nature. But at the root of this argument, I don't see how consolidation makes a dramatic impact. We're after how does the law direct money, consolidation, there's all kinds of incentives today in the law for that to happen, but it's on a voluntary basis on districts.
I totally agree about the three types of districts. If equity, though, is a goal and you want to do something to achieve greater equity, having fewer school districts, going from 850 to 200 or 300 school districts, would statistically produce greater equity. There would be less variation in the revenues. That's just the way it would work.
The proposed plan breaks out categorical still, and you've got the integrated plan, budget, and everything else. Do you have the grade list, or you mentioned already plan on what still is categorical, and how does that list then compare to the vertical equality that you mentioned there?
So the proposal collapses most categorical grant programs into the primary state aid formula. There are a few exceptions. Transportation funding, for example, is not incorporated into the proposed formula because there's already a need. There's a question of need before it's distributed. Special ed, high-cost special education services. There's a few special ed categorical grants that remain independent. The ones that have some measure of need are kept out. Everything else is put in. Bill did mention, you know, the block grant for Chicago. We propose to eliminate that too. That's been a hurdle, but I think most people have embraced that now. Even members from Chicago say that, you know, we got to get rid of these special deals in the formula, and so some are excluded, but the bulk of the categorical spending is incorporated into the proposed formula.
One more.
Okay, Gordon.
If the current formula were fully funded at the state level rather than being prorated, it would cost a certain amount of dollars. The program that you're advocating, could it be implemented equitably for that same amount of dollars?
So rewind the clock. Last week, the governor proposed, consistent with his budget, $55 million to fully fund the foundation level for next fiscal year. So remember that chart where we were all the way to the right? So that 81 cents is going to go down with that extra $55 million. So at some point in time, we have to have the conversation that we do need more. We do need more into what we distribute. But we also need to spend it wisely. And, I give the example of how can fully funding the formula during a time when we have limited state resources, and we will for years to come, let's be honest. So we spend $55 million more in a incredibly strained budget that makes inequity worse in the state. You know, and I think the governor is sincere when he says he wants to tackle this problem. But what I've said to him time and again is, why would we dig the hole deeper before we get out of it? And unfortunately, that's what his proposal does. So I would say that if we have $55 million to spend, we should figure out how to direct it to the places that need it the most, not places that spend well above what's adequate already. And that, again, go back to how we started the conversation. That's the law being exercised. So this isn't just a question of how much we put in. It's a question of how we distribute it. And the formula today doesn't get it to the places that need it the most. And that's been evidenced by what the governor just recently proposed.
Thank you.